Hey, welcome to Non-Standard Models, where we step into the world of theoretical physics. Today I'm here with Dirk Kreimer.
Hi.
And Jens Lücke.
Hey.
Dirk is a professor in mathematical physics at Humboldt University Berlin, and Jens is a PhD student also working at Humboldt University. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you for inviting us.
Dirk dedicated his career to a topic that has fascinated but also haunted physicists for a long time. Infinities, in particular in particle physics. And also Jens spent some time working on this topic. For this reason, today they're here to tell us more about the physical meaning of infinite quantities and how we can deal with them. Throughout the history of physics, infinitely large quantities often appeared unexpectedly in the computation of physical phenomena. Jens, when were infinities first encountered in this field?
Well, one of the underlying principles of particle physics and the description of the microscopic world is quantum mechanics. Already during its development in the 1930s, the theory seemed to predict that electrons interact with an infinite amount of energy. Infinity, however, is a mathematical concept and not really a number which makes sense as the result of a measurement in an experiment. Historically, it took some time and perseverance for physicists to correctly understand these infinities and predict the energy of the electron using the rules of quantum physics. Eventually, the infinity, instead of only being a problem, guided them to a much deeper understanding of the theory.
But is that a general pattern? Do infinities usually convey useful information?
Yes, and actually, as scary as they are, I do love infinities. And this is because at the end of the computation, they go away. And the way they go away, they tell us about the structure of the theory we are interested in, but they also tell us about the mathematics behind that theory. And so much so that we even dare to classify them in not too bad, bad, or fully horrific. And having learned this classification, and having learned how to deal with that, we actually have now a very routine and very well-developed handle to deal with physics.
Good, so how do the infinities appear? How can we deal with them? And what are the problems that physicists are still facing today? Let's find out. Jens, I would like to start by asking you about the energy of the electron that you mentioned before. It seems quite surprising that the output of a computation would be infinite. Can you maybe say something more about this?
Sure. In its simplest form, the interaction between electrons and other fundamental particles, other charged particles, is described by the electric force. This force says that if you take two particles of the same charge and you bring them close together, they repel each other. If you take two particles of opposite charge, you bring them close together, they attract each other. Furthermore, the theory predicts that the strength of the force depends on the distance between the charges. So if you bring the two charges very, very far apart, the strength of the force essentially goes to zero. On the other hand, if you bring the two charges very close together, the force increases and increases endlessly. Towards infinity, you would say.
But this doesn't take into account the fact that real objects have a non-zero size, right? If we physically take two objects close to each other, it is impossible to decrease their distance to zero because they will collide before they reach that point. What if we take this into account, Dirk?
Yes, you're right, but the infinity seemingly arises because we are asking the wrong question. In everyday life, electric force is perfectly well-behaved and correct. But then if we go to the not-so-everyday infinitesimal small distances in particle physics, we need a completely different theory.
Okay, what happens then? What happens when an electron, which is negative charge, approaches a particle with positive charge?
Well, then we cannot use our understanding of electric forces anymore. We are now in the realm of particle physics, and that means we need really quantum physics here. Infinities which we get from trying to describe this by electric forces simply come from the fact that this is the wrong theory which we apply. So when we go to particle physics, we have a much better chance to get a correct result. But this does not mean that we abandon electric forces. It just means we restrict the applications to a range where they are valid.
Indeed, in the realm of quantum physics, particles behave very differently from everyday life. At small scales, electrons in some cases behave as point-like particles, in other cases they're more spread out like a wave. So the meaning of their exact position becomes unclear. Dirk, can we say that quantum physics helped us solve this problem and that it makes infinity disappear?
Yes and no. In quantum physics, particles are not considered
as point-like particles anymore.
And so the electric forces have their limited range of distances
where we can apply them.
But then, when we go to quantum physics,
and very small distances,
we have to make sure that quantum physics does not give rise to new infinities.
Yeah, it's true that in quantum physics has the potential to introduce new infinities. In quantum physics, there is a key concept, which is called uncertainty principle, that states that we cannot know exactly all the properties of a particle. For example, if we want to measure the position with zero uncertainty, we cannot determine at all the speed of the particle. And so what we have to do is like to consider all the infinite values of the speed of this particle and to sum over all of them. And this infinite sum is called an integral. In order to understand if this integral is a problem or not, we need to take an extra step, and we need first to understand how to describe the electromagnetic force in this quantum world. Dirk, can you tell us more about this?
Sure. To understand particle physics, physicists have developed a graphical tool called Fireman Diagrams, named after Dick Fireman,
a very well-known
20th century physicist.
In Fireman Diagrams,
say you have a
propagating electron
and another one,
and they feel
each other's presence
through the interchange
of a photon, which makes you a very elementary
Fireman diagram
in this case. Now, such a Fireman diagram
really
is a task.
It tells the physicist, compute me.
And he has rules
how to do that.
But then he has to sum
over all diagrams
which have the same
incoming
and outgoing particles.
Like we had two incoming
and two outgoing electrons
in our example.
This sum means a sum over
many computations. And once you have done them all,
you have your result.
It's true. Feynman diagrams are really a clever way of representing phenomena, because from them we can extract theoretical predictions thanks to a set of rules that associate each element of the graph with a mathematical quantity. Feynman diagrams are so interesting that they are a research topic on their own. I use them too in my research. But now, Jens, when do these integrals appear in these diagrams?
Well, as you said, when drawing a phenomenon with Feynman diagrams, we have to be careful to the presence of particles whose properties we cannot observe. For example, if we consider the process that Dirk just mentioned, where the two electrons feel each other's presence through the photon, in the quantum mechanical world, we have to also consider the case where the photon can split into an electron and a positron, a particle similar to the electron, but just with positive charge. And even though we don't know the properties of these particles, they're of crucial importance in quantum physics.
Sure, because of the uncertainty principle, we cannot measure everything that's going on, so we have to sum over all the undetermined possibilities.
Exactly. And in this particular example, we need to sum over all the possible values of the speed that the two hidden particles can have. Still, there is hope, because even though the sum is infinite and we're summing infinitely many things, the result is not necessarily infinite. Because the theory also predicts that the larger the energy, the less likely a particle is to have it. So sometimes we get lucky and the two effects compensate each other, such that we end up with a finite quantity.
But still, there are some diagrams in which this compensation is insufficient, and so the integral is infinite, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. If this happens, we generate an infinity. This is the case, for example, for the electric interaction diagram, where an electron and a photon encounter and the electron feels the electric force. Here, the electron can emit a photon which is reabsorbed by itself after the interaction. The closer this happens to the point of interaction, the larger its contribution to the sum. Here, the compensation does not suffice to make the sum finite, and we generate an infinity. This infinity, we call it short distance infinity or ultraviolet divergence. And although we do not expect to measure this exact emission and absorption in an experiment, this is still the way we represent it mathematically.
So this is still an effect that arises at very small distance scales. Like the infinity arises when the electron emits or absorbs a photon, which is, seems problematic. But Dirk, does it mean that we have to replace our quantum theory with something else that describes even smaller distance scales?
No, but yes, you are right. The problem is in the small distance scales. And contrary to the electric forces, it stays with us. Because by the rules of quantum physics, we have to consider all possibilities, including very short distances. So the infinity is not going away. But we have to reconsider what is a physical theory. It's basically a philosophical point. And here we have to be pragmatic. What we expect from a physical theory is to be able to make predictions and tells us or predicts the outcome of an experiment. And so it does. And so it makes me happy. And you as well, or?
Sure. But Jens, how can we make sense of a theory that gives rise to infinities when performing calculations?
It turns out that the infinities actually cancel on our physical predictions. Let's illustrate this with a simple example. Let's say we want to determine how good a pizza is. We taste only one pizza, we can never say whether it's excellent or not. If we establish, however, a reference pizza, a reference experiment, so to say, we can compare all future pizzas to the reference pizza in many different criteria. We can even do more. We can even make predictions. Because if we take now better quality ingredients, we'll probably end up with a better tasting pizza. Sure, this example is not a very physical one, but it does show how we deal with the problem of these infinities. We cannot make predictions for a single experiment, but what we can do is make predictions for differences between experiments. In this way, the infinities that arise due to the hidden small-scale effects cancel in the result. Then we do a single measurement, and from there on can make accurate and successful predictions for all future experiments.
Okay, so the infinity in the calculation cancel to result in a finite prediction, but is it really satisfying? Don't we want a theory that makes prediction for individual experiment without relying on input from other measurements?
Well, the theory of the electron is not a theory of everything. In our pizza example, a theory of everything would enable us to predict the quality of any pizza without us ever having eaten at least one. We do not have such a theory. We need a little bit of experience from experiment to make our theory predictive. What that means is, assume you know the outcome of one experiment involving an electron, a positron, and a photon. Then we can predict the outcome of any other experiment involving such particles. This is actually very impressive. And this is what we now call a predictive theory. Some modest, finite number of experiments knowledge input allows you to predict an infinite number of experiments which can possibly happen. This, in our viewpoint, is very satisfying.
This is surely impressive, but how can we be sure that infinities will always cancel, even if we consider completely different processes?
Well, if you look, for example, at the theory of electron, positron, and photon, as we just did, there and in other theories, you can prove it from combinatorical mathematical methods. It is complicated and it takes time, and with friends and colleagues, we spend some time on that, but now the proof is there. It's purely mathematical in the sense it does not need any input from experiment. It's pure thought, and pure thought allows you to show with mathematical precision that from a finite number of input experiments, you can predict the whole world for you. And the infinities, therefore, play for you an extremely important conceptual role in showing how the observable world is organized. So, Giulia, those infinities,
they are hiding beautiful mathematical structures.
That's true, but before we all fall in love with infinities, we should know if it's possible to treat them successfully in all our theories. Is it the case, Jens?
Well, electrons and photons are only a few of the particles in nature. After some hard work, physicists, and among those Dirk, have developed the mathematical tools to treat the infinities in almost all of the theories that we find in nature. We describe the universe with four fundamental forces: electromagnetism, the strong and the weak nuclear force, and gravity. In three of the four, we know how to successfully treat the infinities, namely in electromagnetism, the strong and the weak nuclear force. However, in gravity, it remains a mystery if or how we can treat the infinities there.
But this is strange, because without a doubt, gravity is the most familiar force to all of us. So what's the challenge in studying this theory, Dirk?
Well, it's difficult to treat gravity with our current rules of quantum physics. Any number of gravitons can interact in a point-like manner. And this translates into that we would have to do any number of experiments to make gravity predictive. And that's basically impossible to achieve. Sure, if you want to have a working, so-and-so precise theory of gravity, we could just cut off energy somewhere. And then we have an effective field theory of gravity, if you like. You can deal with that for some time until your experiments become more accurate. So we are trading in accuracy for the ability to do gravity. But if you really want to do precise experiments and really want to understand everything, so we want to eat and understand and predict any pizza under the sun, then we have to learn more.
It is surely fascinating. Today we have discussed the infinities of the point-like charge, the electron. These infinities were successfully treated, and they opened a path to a deeper understanding of the theories describing our world. Yet, the story has not been fully written. Gravity is still missing, and future discoveries on fascinating objects such as black holes will certainly bring new elements in the picture. For now, infinitely many thanks to both of you for your explanations.
Well, I happily return. Infinitely many thanks to you, Giulia.
And thank you for watching. See you next time here on Non-Standard Models.